Welcome to our Summerstrand United Church Sunday service. We're so glad that you've joined us today, and we hope you'll enjoy the service with us.
Good morning, as you see. COVID has surely made it difficult for all of us to follow a daily routine that we were once used to. But when we get despondent, we should go back to Psalm 34, where David is writing to proclaim the fact that God is always good and that the Lord will hear you at all times. So we need to be reminded of that. And therefore, I would like to read to you from Psalm 34, verse 17 to 20. Pray to the Lord and he will hear you. He will save you from all your troubles. The Lord is close to those who have suffered disappointment. He saves those who are discouraged. Good people might have many problems, but the Lord will take them all away. He will protect them completely. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we have entered another period of lockdown. Many people are anxious, Father, and it can be tough to stay positive. We thank you for the encouragement and example in the psalm of what David did in his times of trouble. We know that in life brokenness and afflictions will come, but we will always know that you are mighty to save and will deliver us from the fire. May we now experience your love and appreciate the blessing to be part of this special time of worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold, battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, are to rage against the captor. And with a sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure. And Christ will have the prize for which he died, an inheritance of nations. Arise, shine.
Crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror is risen. And as the stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, his victory march continues till the day, every eye and heart shall see him. So Spirit, come, strength in every stride, give grace to every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful.
Oh,
you for the cross. Thank you for the price you paid. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for unending grace. Thank you for your hope. Thank you for this life you gave. There is no one like you. There is no one like you, God. All my hope is in you,
your face shine on us. Oh, let your face. Today's message is called Compassion, as we continue in Mark's Gospel. We have an Old Testament read from 2 Kings chapter 4 from verse 42. Won't you follow with me in your Bible or on your app? A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing the man of God 20 loaves of barley bread, baked from the first ripe corn, along with some heads of new corn. Give it to the people to eat, Elisha said. How can I set this before 100 men? The servant asked. But Elisha answered, give it to the people to eat, for this is what the Lord says. They will eat and have some left over. Then he set it before them, and they ate, and they had some left over, according to the word of the Lord. And across into Mark's Gospel, chapter 6, from verse 30. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. This is the word of the Lord, friends. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your compassion for us. Thank you that you've called us again on the Lord's Day to gather around your word. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would speak to us, that you would open our minds and our hearts to your teaching, that we may grow together in Christ, and that we may serve you and love you in this world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I think we would all agree that the world today is a very needy place. There are physical, emotional, and spiritual needs all around us, even amongst us today who are gathered together around God's word. Well, as we can see, a couple of thousand years ago, that it was just the same. Human nature is needy by nature, and lockdown level 4 has once again brought our needs to the surface, as you and I know so very well. So Elisha, let's go back 850 years BC. It's about that time that he is called to serve God, and on this occasion, he received 20 loaves of freshly baked bread from the early harvest, perhaps just for his own use or a couple of the people close to him. But Elisha said, give it to the people to eat. And the servant answers with a kind of confused tone, you know, how can I give this, how can I put these 20 loaves before all these people, before 100 men? There's not enough. Elisha said, just go ahead and do it. God says there's enough. And sure enough, they pass the bread around and there's an abundance. There are leftovers. Just reflects how this God we serve is a God of abundance. And when he supplies abundantly. Elisha was a man of God. He was called to honor God. He was called to serve God. But he was also called to serve God's people. And even though this provision has been for himself, he has compassion on those around him and he shares what he has. God prompted him to share and God provides in abundance. So what kind of bread do you like? Do you like rye? Do you like brown? Do you like whole wheat? Do you like ciabatta bread, as I love ciabatta bread? Do you sometimes go down to cobblestones and buy their ciabatta? Or the other day we were across at the grass roof and discovered their wonderful ciabatta as well. So even though some of these places are closed for you to sit down, you're still able to buy something fresh from them during lockdown, which is so important. Do you make your own bread? Jesus said, I am the bread of life. And when he supplies, there is abundance. So let's think about that as we're going to learn about compassion during this lockdown period. So fast forward now, 850 years to the days of Jesus. We were around Elisha now in the days of Jesus. And we're asking this question today. Is God still concerned about our needs during lockdown level 4? So let's have a look at the Word of God. The apostles, verse 30 in Mark chapter 6, the apostle gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught there. Because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. So we see this first part of Jesus' compassion. It is invitational. Come with me. What an amazing invitation. Perhaps we're in lockdown level 4, friends, because some of us haven't responded yet to that invitation of Jesus. To come away with me. To come away with me and to be present with me. And here's the reality that we believe as believers, is that when we go into the quiet with Jesus, what we hear from him changes how we live. It changes how we live, friends. Let's think of people who are on the front lines in hospitals and clinics who have got this rush and busyness around them where it's difficult to have quiet. Let's consider them as we consider this text. Jesus says, come away with me by yourselves and get some rest. So have you responded yet during COVID to this invitation of Jesus to come away with him? Why? Why do we need to get away with him? Because otherwise we're just involved with human effort, which we know is often busy and unfruitful. But when we take time to hear from him in the quiet, we become these spirit-filled believers. It's so different. You can see it in our lives. I know it in my own life. When my life is just, you know, functioning out of a dry place versus a place where I've taken time to be quiet before God and heard from him and invited his spirit into my life, and then life becomes more fruitful. So when we are alone with Jesus in the quiet, what we hear from him changes how we live. It gives us the courage to live invitational lives, to cross boundaries, to live in a different way for Christ. So now, the movie The Green Book, called The Green Book, tells the true story of Dr. Don Shirley, a world-class black pianist living in a suite at Carnegie Hall. So Dr. Shirley plans a trip out away from the safety of his Manhattan residence into a world that has not fully embraced the new realities of desegregation. He's planned a cross-country concert tour that will take him into the heart of the South, and we know that what that looks like. So the story begins with Dr. Shirley searches for a qualified driver, one that can also serve as an intimidating deterrent to anyone wanting to cause trouble. So during the interview process, Dr. Shirley meets Tony Vallelonga, who is an Italian Bronx-born bouncer who holds a subtle prejudice against people of color. So as they prepare to leave from the safety of the big city, Tony is handed a green book. And this catalog was a guide written for African Americans traveling into the deep South during the years of Jim Crow. And of course, that was those laws that legalized racial segregation, just like we had in this country. So the movie follows the development of their friendship as they navigate through the Jim Crow reality of the era. As the relationship grows, Dr. Shirley learns to embrace the crass unsophistication of his chauffeur. Tony, in turn, learns to accept Dr. Shirley as an equal, as he begins to care deeply about the abuse and prejudice endured by his employer-turned-friend. He does not understand why Dr. Shirley chose to visit an area so resistant to his presence, or why he continues to press forward in spite of the constant rejection. It's just a kind of a question he has. At one point in the story, Tony is standing outside a palatial plantation where Dr. Shirley has just performed. While the aristocracy accepts Dr. Shirley as a performer, they continue to mistreat him as a human being. Tony, speaking with Oleg, a close friend and associate of Dr. Shirley, Oleg explains why Dr. Shirley chose to come to the Deep South, why he had this courage. You asked me once why Dr. Shirley does this. I tell you, because genius is not enough. It takes courage to change people's hearts. Today, we think knowledge is the currency that buys change. If we can just educate enough, if we can just get the message out, then we could change our community. We freely share our wisdom, in inverted commas, and opinions, in inverted commas, really recognizing the difference. And as we do, we mistakenly think that we are changing our world, because knowledge is power, or so we say. Oleg's statement would teach us something different, friends. By itself, knowledge is useless. It is a dormant instrument, an idle tool, until wielded by a willing workman. And when an instrument is used in an attempt to work on people, to change people's hearts, this requires courage, Holy Spirit courage, Jesus invitational courage that crosses barriers. Genius is not enough, because knowledge is useless without the courage to love. Compassionate invitational courage. Paul knew the power of genius, but he knew that it is wasted unless the person who holds it is willing to use it in a demonstration of courageous love. 1 Corinthians 12 verse 2. And if I have prophetic powers, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith, so as to remove mountains, but if I have not love, I am nothing. Moving on into the text, verse 32 of Mark 6. So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. And when Jesus landed and he saw this massive crowd, he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many, many things. You see, not only is Jesus' compassion invitational, friends, but Jesus' compassion is also instructional. It puts God's word at the center. You wouldn't have thought, with this massive crowd and the tiredness of the disciples, that God's word was going to be instrumental in meeting the needs of these people. You see, the good news spreads rapidly. And Jesus was nearby, so this crowd was pressing. And so this trip didn't allow much rest at all for the disciples, didn't it? Wasn't much time for quiet and solitude as this crowd arrived. And the size of the needy crowd didn't cause stress and struggle within Jesus, the perfect spiritual man, God. He knows that as he reaches out to the Father, as he sees what the Father is doing, he will be able to meet the needs of this crowd. And Jesus is moved to compassion. He's still seeing things very clearly. He's a seer, S-E-E-R, as we spoke about in the midweek message. Jesus saw through their needy outer layer, and he reaches in to their spiritual needs. And so he teaches them many things. He gave them his life-giving message. Are we still being intentional in this COVID season? Are we being intentional with God's word, friends? Are we pointing people to Jesus? Are we pointing people to God's word? So you've heard about Richard Dawkins, haven't you? I mean, I certainly have, and I know that you have. Once asked what he planned to say when he died and stood before God, the prominent anti-theist Richard Dawkins responded, "I will say, sir, why have you hidden yourself so well?" But has he really? Has God really hidden himself? Well, scripture, again, the word teaches us something quite different. It offers some important truths concerning the evidence of God's existence. And let's be honest, friends, people are still crying out for God in COVID. People are still asking, you know, does he care for me? Is he real? And what does the word actually say about this? Well, The heavens declare the work of his hands, and therefore the reality of his being. Psalm 19, 1 to 6. Because of this awe-invoking wonder of creation, those who don't believe in God are labeled fools. Psalm 14, verse 1. Who have made themselves eagerly oblivious to existence. 2 Peter 3, verse 5. Those who live as though they believe in a universe without God are without excuse. Romans 1, verse 20. So if this is true, then one would think that the more we learn about the universe, the more we should become certain of God's existence. So, and his greatness. So science seems to constantly graze against theology while not embracing the truth that it implies. So in a Newsweek article titled Welcome to the Multiverse, Brian Greene explains the origin of what was once considered science fiction. Namely, that not only are we not alone in the universe, but our universe is not alone in reality. His explanation begins with the origins of the Big Bang Theory. So Greene expands, and before long, scientists reason that if space is now expanding, that then at ever earlier times, the universe must have been even smaller and ever smaller. At some moment in the distant past, everything we now see, the ingredients responsible for every planet, every star, every galaxy, even space itself, must have been compressed into an infinitesimal speck that then swelled outward, evolving into the universe as we know it. The Big Bang Theory was born. So during the decades that followed, the theory would receive overwhelming observational support, which we know. So, yet scientists were aware that the Big Bang Theory suffered from a significant shortcoming. Of all things, it leaves out the bang. Einstein's equations do a wonderful job of describing how the universe evolved from a split second after the bang. But the equations break down, similar to the error message that when you use a calculator or on your phone, when you try to divide 1 by 0, you get an error message when applied to the extreme environment of the universe's earliest moments. So the Big Bang thus provides no insight into what might have powered the bang itself. But again, scripture teaches something different. So friends, are we turning people, are we being courageous about turning people to God's word during COVID? Scripture says there is in fact a multiverse, at least one more, that exists outside the fallen one we currently occupy. It had an origin. It had an originator. Imagine it. Human knowledge has reached a place where it can empirically theorize heaven. And yet many choose to imagine a universe without God. Belief is and always has been a choice. So there was a time when creation sprang into being, a point past which scientific equations break down, a split second instant before the bang, where the laws which govern our universe don't seem to apply. This is a place where science must be silent. The Big Bang provides no insight into what might have powered the bang itself, but scripture does. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness, friends. The scriptures have an answer to our questions. Are we being courageous during this COVID, particularly now as we're in lockdown level 4? What are we sharing with our friends? Are we drawing them to the scriptures? Are we being courageous in sharing God's life? Are we putting the word of God at the center? Jesus taught them. He taught this crowd many things. Would have been amazing to be there, wouldn't it? So, but then as the story moves on, we realize that the compassion of Jesus is extremely practical. It meets the physical needs. Not only does he meet their emotional and their spiritual needs, but he meets their physical needs, as the story goes on to tell them. So by this time, verse 35, it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. This is a remote place, I mean, as if Jesus didn't know that. They said, it's already very late, as if he didn't know that. Send the people away so they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat. Jesus' answer is just so profound. But he answered them, you give them something to eat. So the disciples, they see this incredible needy crowd, and their solution is, their solution to getting rid of the need is, well, send these people away. Let them go and buy their own food. But Jesus always works differently, doesn't he? The Jesus way of compassion is always different to ours. This massive need during COVID, massive need in your family, my family, you know, the needs around us, the Jesus way is different. The disciples would have sent them away, but Jesus is at work and he wants them to see something different. He wants them to see the kingdom of God in action. Just like Elijah and Elisha, you know, if you see me when I leave, Elijah says to Elisha, then you will receive this double portion of my Holy Spirit, of God's Holy Spirit in your life. So they said to him, that would take more than a half a year's wages. This is the disciples. Are we going to spend money, that much money, to buy bread and give it to them to eat? You see, there's a kind of this fatalism amongst the disciples, which we also get during these seasons of struggle, during COVID. But Jesus wants to move them from fatalism to faith. And maybe that's your journey today as you read this story, as you hear this sermon. Jesus wants to move you from fatalism to faith, friends. The disciples are not seeing much here. Are we not the same? We look at the problem, you know, from an earthly point of view. Jesus looks at it from a heavenly point of view. So they're not really yet fully aware of the abundant resources that the God of heaven on earth has. You know, fatalism just leads to anxiety. More and more of it. Faith is the sense of God's peace, that he is our provider. How many loaves do you have? Verse 38, he asked. Go and see. And when they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. You know, Oakland, Bicky, I mean, it seems like nothing. What are you going to do with, you know, a couple of loaves and a few fish? It's not gonna, you know, it's just enough for a little modern day nuclear family. Not enough to share, not for a multitude of people. But God just doesn't want to meet the needs of the disciples. He doesn't want to just have a little meal with his gathered group. He loves the multitudes. He loves those who are far from him, those who are needy, those who are hungry emotionally and spiritually and physically. What is your need today, friends? Jesus loves the crowd. He wants to share this meal with the multitudes. And so he's seeing things differently. He looks at the world differently. This, friends, and God's provision always begins with what we have. It always begins with what we have. You know, it's a tiny amount, the few fish and the loaves, but that's the starting point with what you have. It's no good praying for God's provision in the greater needs of our lives when we haven't been godly with what we have. Is what you have currently, friends, is it yielded to God? Is it yielded to God? Even though it may only be a little. And then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups in the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and 50, taking the loaves and the 2 fish, looking up to heaven. And he gave thanks and he broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to distribute to the people. And he also divided the 2 fish among them. And they ate and they were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 baskets. There was this abundance of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of men who had eaten was 5,000, friends. This is God our provider. This is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. So he creates some order. He says, let's do this in a manageable, orderly way. It reminds us of Jesus, of David in Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. He leads me into these green pastures. He lets me lie down and he gives me rest and he provides for me. The ancient Greek word for groups is a very pictorial word. It's the normal Greek word used for rows of vegetables in a veggie garden. When you look like if you had a drone looking down at these little groups, as they sat there in their ordinary rows, they looked for all the world like little rows of vegetables, you know, sort of planted all systematically. God works in an orderly, systematic way in our lives, friends, when he provides for us, but he always begins with what we have. And he expects us to use what we have in a godly, orderly way. And Jesus deviated from the norm here when he prayed. He looked up to heaven. We don't, you know, we pray for our food. It's not that we want God to bless us. That we're looking up, we're blessing God, saying, thank you, Lord, for what you have provided in my life. So friends, today as we're going to gather around the Lord's table, let's consider his love for us. Let's consider this God who provides in abundance. Let's consider what we have and how we may use it in his kingdom. Are we yielded to him as we gather around this table? As we gather around the Lord's table, friends, let's consider David's words of comfort, God's compassion, his provision. Let's pray. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Father, we thank you for your grace today. We thank you for your compassion, Lord Jesus. We thank you that you pursue us with your love. I pray today, Lord, for those gathered in their homes, wherever they may be, as family or with friends or just perhaps somebody by themselves, that your Holy Spirit would be so present, so evident. Your love would be so tangible, so vivid, so clear. Your compassion, your kindness, so much surrounding each child, each grandparent. We consider your great love for us today around this table. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, this is the Lord's table. It is the table of his love. It is the table of his compassion. As you have your bread with you, as you have the cup, the juice, which represents the vineyard, we are his vineyard, we are his flock. He is our good shepherd. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. He bleeds from the cross for us to give us healing, to give us hope. Let's think of those who have lost loved ones recently as we gather around this table. Let's think of those who are far from God, those who are struggling emotionally, physically and spiritually. You have people you know who are struggling, who've lost their jobs, they're without provision. Let's pray that they will turn to God today. Let's pray that we will yield ourselves to God today. That he will begin with the little that we have and multiply it. And even as we do that, friends, let's say together this ancient creed, which crystallizes everything we believe as Christians in lockdown. Level 4. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so now, friends, as we take this bread and we take this cup, as you take yours at home, let's remember we're setting them apart from their ordinary use to this holy mystery, which is communion with God. Today we receive the compassion of the Lord Jesus Christ. We receive his great love for us, his eternal love, which is not like human love. We receive the knowledge again that he's coming again to be with us forever. He's taking us to be with him. We're on a journey with God. We're trusting him to send rain in season. We're trusting him to bring an end to COVID in his perfect timing. We're trusting that this bread and this wine will become to us new life. Take the bread, and you want to take your bread at home, and we break it as Jesus broke it on the night that he was betrayed, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so too, after supper, as we take the cup, he took the cup, which he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood." Each time you drink of this cup, we are proclaiming, friends, that he will return, that he is coming again. In Jesus' name, amen. And so I want you to take bread now and feed those who are around you, saying this is the body of Christ. Jesus is the bread of life. He meets every emotional, every spiritual, every physical need in Christ. Let's pass one another the bread of life, friends, and let's eat together. So now I want you to take the cup as you pass around to each other, remembering that this is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as we look at the cross, friends, this cup reminds us that the cross is empty, that the tomb is empty, that we have a new day, a new dawn, you and your family together. And we're saying thank you as we look up. We're saying thank you, God, that you are our provider. We're saying that we yield ourselves, the little we have, we're giving it to you. Won't you be Lord of every area of our lives? Let's give one another the cup of the new covenant. And let's drink together. Friends, even as you have eaten, as you drink this cup, you acknowledge the Lord's presence right here, right with us today. acknowledging, Lord, that we are a needy people. So many emotional, so many spiritual, so many physical needs. Won't you just remember now the names of those who have gone before us? We want to lift up to you Marissa and her family, Lord, with the loss of Umquis. Tani Marianne, we think of that whole family. Johan and the little ones. We pray your blessing on them. May you comfort them. May you bring them your peace in this difficult journey. And there are those you know, friends. You've perhaps lost loved ones yourself, your friends, during this COVID season, perhaps recently, or there's still that ache of last year. So won't you let your needs be met in Christ Jesus today around this table. Jesus is our host, friends. The Lord Jesus is our host. We come to him. Holy Spirit, we ask that you administer your peace to us, your joy. Give us a sense of the eternal, that we are just passing through this life. Good Shepherd, won't you comfort us again? In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, SUC family. What a privilege it's been to gather around God's Word again today. We are so thankful for our very special SUC community. It's been such a blessing to witness the kindness and generosity of our church family. Our faithful commitment to monthly tithing ensures that our ministry, worship, and outreach continues. If you need more information, feel free to go to our website, www.summerstrandunited.co.za.